Hello. Today, I'll be walking you through how you can use DeepSeek R1 on your own local computer. This will essentially allow you to run an AI on your own PC without Wi-Fi, securing your data from the outside world. Let's hop over to the computer so I can show you how it's done. I'm going to make this tutorial as digestible as possible, no matter what your proficiency is in AI. So if you don't know what DeepSeek R1 is, DeepSeek R1 just released 9 hours ago as of the making of this video, in which it's an open source AI that benchmarks really close to closed source models such as ChatGPT's O1, their flagship model. This essentially gives normal people like you and I the ability to train models that compete with these closed end models, which is phenomenal. This removes the idea of all this power in one person's hand and is now dispersing that for everyone to enjoy. So why would you want to use an LLM like DeepSeek R1 locally? Well, for one, it's very private. When you use an AI such as ChatGPT that communicates with a server in which ChatGPT or OpenAI can collect your information and use it for further training. What a local AI does is it's an AI that's ran strictly off your own hardware and it doesn't connect to the internet. So if your Wi-Fi goes out, you can still have AI by your side. So how do you install an AI model for you to use locally? Well, the best software for this is LM Studio. So let's hop over to the website. So on lmstudio.ai, you can see the different download links for the different platforms. Pick the one that is right for you. When you open up your program, it'll look something along the lines of this. You have your main chat interface over here, and you have a list of your previous chats over here. Before installing any models, let's look at what the different sizes of the models mean and what that means specifically for us. Looking at the DeepSeek's GitHub, we can scroll down here and we can see that the normal model is 671 billion parameters big. This basically means for every single response that it's generating, it'll take into consideration 671 billion parameters. Your PC is likely not able to do all these computations required. This would require roughly 20 consumer grade GPUs to actually run this thing. So the only way for you to run this version of the model is through DeepSeek's API and using API calls, which to be honest is still cheap. If we look at their pricing for this model, we can see that for 1 million tokens of input, basically every single token is one word. So every time that you type something into ChatGPT, your prompt is split into tokens, which then the AI digests and makes decisions upon. And so for 1 million words that you type to it, you're only going to pay 55 cents. Likewise, for every 1 million words that it generates for you, you're going to spend around $2.20. If you don't know how expensive this is, for reference, ChatGPT charges around $15 per 1 million input. Additionally, they charge around $60 for every 1 million tokens of output, which is outrageous. So if your computer can't run any of these models, then please consider this. It's still a great, great value. And back over to the GitHub, luckily for us, they created these R1 distill models, which contain smaller amounts of parameters, which allows us to run these models on a wider variety of machines. This is incredible what DeepSeek has done, especially in the realm of open source, where now people with even lesser quality machines can fine-tune this AI and run it locally. So back over to LM Studio, you want to click on the Discover tab, which is this magnifying glass icon. If your Discover page is not populating like this, then you'll want to come back to the home page and download the model that's listed here. After that, you should have all these different options. And for the sake of this tutorial, I'm going to download the Llama 8 billion parameter model. So click download, and here you'll see it start to download. This will take about 10 minutes depending on how fast your internet speed is, but is roughly 5 gigabytes, so it's gonna take a little while no matter how good of internet you have. While this is downloading, let's talk about what all you can do with this. If you have a Raspberry Pi, which is a microcomputer, you can install something called Home Assistant and create a server in which you can run this AI through your house, kind of like Alexa. You can have it control all your smart devices, including your TV, your security cameras, your router settings, everything, which is far superior to Amazon's Alexa because Alexa works by communicating to Amazon servers and then getting back to you. If your Wi-Fi goes out, you can't control your smart lamps anymore. Not only that, but Alexa also collects your data. So if you want a very privatized network, then consider doing this as an alternative. Once your model is successfully downloaded, you'll see in the bottom right, it says load model. So click on that, and you'll be immediately sent to this screen where you can see that your model is loading up top. By clicking on this test tube icon, you can input a system prompt. A system prompt is essentially a co-prompt that is sent in conjunction with your normal prompt, which can kind of set the role of the model and also kind of tell it what you're looking for as like a general theme. So you can give it a profession or act in a certain manner. Whatever you specify, it'll do, and keep this system prompt in mind. I'm gonna leave all the settings default for now and click up here to close this tab. Now we can type in whatever we want and it'll be ran locally like magic. So I'm gonna say, tell me a funny story involving a raccoon and a toothbrush. And you can see up here that the first portion of the response is put in between these two flags of think. And that's because it's doing what is called a chain of thought or COT portion of the response. Basically, it's thinking out what it wants to say before it gets back to you in order to have a more well thought out response and also have the response worded in an elegant way, which removes far more errors than we've ever seen before, making it very accurate and making sure that everything just makes sense. You can notice down in the bottom right, you can see your system usage of the AI model. Where it was running, it was about 0.9% of my CPU, and now that it stopped, it is now not using any of my CPU. To close the model and have it stop working, we can click on eject, and that'll basically allow us to load another model that we have. When you click on a model to load, you'll be given a bunch of optimization parameters for you to kind of tune your own system if you're experiencing any performance issues. So you can select the context length. Context length is essentially how far back in the conversation you want it to remember in order to generate new ideas for you. So this model in particular has a very high context length capability. So it can be set very high. So many, many prompts down the road, it can remember what you first said to it, which is very, very nice when it comes to coding. But do keep in mind, as this warning is telling you, the higher your context length, the more memory or RAM it's going to use when you're using it. So I'm gonna set this back down to around 6,000 tokens. The GPU offload is how much of the computations you wanna send to your GPU to free up your CPU. The CPU thread pool size is how much of the CPU you wanna use dedicated to generating model responses. And the rest of these settings are different settings for you to check out if you're experiencing performance issues. If you're still experiencing performance issues, then you might wanna check out a smaller parameter model, such as the 1.5 billion parameter. This would likely be ideal for laptops and MacBooks, and also PCs without GPUs. Once you have your settings dialed in, click on load model, and that's how you load a model the normal way. So every time that you close this app and reopen it, there's a chance that there's not a model selected yet. So you'll want to go up here, select your model, and load it. On the left side here, you can see all of our chat history, and it'll save it across all your sessions, and you can even choose different models between all your chats. Over in the developer tab, you can see your active models, which ones are active, which ones are currently generating prompts, and you can kind of have an overview of all the different things that you currently have activated and have their different endpoints activated as well. So if we come up here, we can turn it on. If we look down in this chat, we can see these different endpoints in which we can use an OpenAI like API in our local scripts and different programs. So if you're developing a web app that uses an AI integration, you can use your local AI instead of your normal API key in order to debug and test your program. Then when you ship it for production, you can just plug and play your normal API key for all your clients to use. In the next tab, you have all your models that you currently have installed, and you can manage them and uninstall them if you want to free up space on your PC. And then we obviously have the Discover page where you can download many other things. So that's about it. I hope you guys found this information to be valuable. If you did, please leave a like and subscribe. It would mean a whole lot to me. If you also want to learn how you can code with DeepSeek V3 and integrate it into something such as Cursor, that'll be the video that's coming on screen now. Thank you so much.